Stop telling me that I'm pretty for a dark-skinned girl.
Stop telling me to calm down. I don't have an attitude.
Stop telling me how to wear my hair.
Stop telling me I'm a few shades from not being attractive.
Stop telling me what I'm mixed with. I'm black.
Stop telling me to stop wearing makeup to look like a light-skinned girl.
Stop telling me I'm not black because I have albinism.
Stop telling me I'm pretty for someone who isn't light-skinned.
My name is Brittany McCray, and I'm 29 years old. I'm from Kentwood, Louisiana.
Maybe when I was younger, I felt like my skin complexion like deterred me from doing a lot of things because I felt like in the dating world, the guys did not want to talk to me because I was dark-skinned. And growing up in a small town, colorism for me is a big issue. I didn't know what to call it then, but now I know what it is. But it's a big thing there. People gravitate towards, you know, light-skinned girls and women who are light-skinned. So I felt like I wasn't valued or that anything I did, I really had to go above and beyond because I was dark-skinned. Do I feel like it could affect me in my career life? Honestly, now that I'm older, no. More so in relationships because I actually worked at a company and I was the only black girl there and they had never hired a black before with this skin tone. So actually, I actually think it helped me in my career-wise as I got older. It might have hindered me younger, but as I got older, being dark-skinned and I guess being able to articulate helped me with job interviews in the long run. In dating life, I guess being treated differently with the skin tone, I mean, guys automatically assume that I'm dark-skinned, I'm ratchet, I'm ghetto, you know, I'm gonna be loud and extra at the restaurant, and when I come and can talk to you sensibly, oh, I wasn't expecting it, well, I mean, what do you think? I mean, I don't have to be ghetto and ratchet, that's just a persona that y'all think, you know, dark-skinned black girls have, or that I'm bald-headed, that's a good one. That dark-skinned girls don't have hair, and I just don't understand that misconception either. I've experienced that. Girls I know have experienced that. It's just a common misconception that, you know, we are somehow lesser or, you know, our looks don't matter or that we just don't take care of ourselves, and I don't agree with that, you know, but some people, they feel like that. I despise the statement, you're pretty for a dark-skinned girl. I have gotten it my entire life. And once again, I didn't know then, so I took it as a compliment. Now I get very offended because why can't I just be pretty?
skin is yellow. My hair is long. Between two worlds, I do belong. My father was rich and white. He forced my mother late one night. What do they call me? My name is Sophronia.
I'm Megan Callier. I'm 26 years old. I'm originally from Mobile, Alabama. I currently reside in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Been here for about 2 years. I am a mom of one amazing three-year-old. And I'm what we like to call light, bright, damn near white. My nickname, crazily enough, coming up in middle school and high school, was Casper, right? Because on top of this light skin, I have this huge head, right? Initially, you know, you hear about them all the time and they kind of sting, but at some point in my life, I just kind of accepted them. By the way, those two nicknames came from the black community, definitely not the white community. And so by the time I got to like eighth grade, I just put it as a nickname on the back of my shirt. I'll never forget that. Being on a step team at church and everybody needed a nickname, and I was so tired of not embracing it that I just decided to own it. And that was the nickname that I put on the back of my shirt. We're very competitive for some reason. And so like at 26 years old, I think that I'm just getting to that place of like, okay, I love all black women. I went to all black high school and pretty much feeling like I had to be really ghetto to make friends because what I look like didn't fit the status quo. You know what I'm saying? Like it's, I dated the thugs. Like I wanted the most rugged, thugged boy in the school to show you like I'm black. You know what I'm saying? Like I'm relatable. I listen to trap music. Like I'm a dancer, you know, I can pop, I can twerk. I wanted so bad to prove my blackness because black women like to shun me. I'm not sure why that is, because I never felt like a brown-skinned woman had anything to prove to me. Like, hey, girl, you know, it's weird. I don't know. I don't know what it is about my skin that makes you feel like I'm not relatable. I'm not woke. I'm not a part of the real blackness, a part of the real struggle, you know? You have no idea, like, how many times in my life I've heard, I thought you were stuck up, rude, unintelligent is one I get a lot. I'll remember like my first public speaking engagement literally at Southern. Somebody walked up to me and was like, I didn't know you were smart. Why, you light bright. I've been seeing you out. I read books. I love reading. Like these are just perceptions, I guess, that I'm supposed to be in somebody's music video or, you know, trying to be a model or, I think that I'm somebody because I have this color skin, but really, like, I just kind of want to exist, you know? Like, I want to exist and love on people all the same. I don't think I'm anybody, and my insecurities are ridiculous. I just stopped tanning probably, like, 5 years ago. Like, I tanned religiously, like, memberships. My mom was just like, you're ridiculous. At one point, Sally Hansen has this spray can, y'all. You can go get it. And it smooths over your legs. It gives you like a little glow. And because I thought I was so pale, I literally used to go in Walgreens and just throw it on the basket. Like I was a cheerleader and a dancer, so my legs were always out, but I thought they were too pale. Like people were, you so white. Like If I walked up to you and told you, you so black, you crunchy black, you'd be like, oh shit, that bitch. Like, you know what I'm saying? Who you think you talking to? You know what I'm saying? But yet, you gonna make me feel insecure and walk up to me and tell me that I need a tan. Real polite. You know what I'm saying? It's just that double standard, because I could never tell somebody, and I would never want to tell anybody, you should consider bleaching your skin. You're really dark. Like, it's the exact, you're telling me the exact same thing, that there's something wrong with the skin that I'm in. There's nothing wrong with me being pale. This is like literally how God made me. Why are you telling me to change it? Because you would cuss out a white person that told you to change yours. So yeah, I'm not stuck up. I'm not rude. I think I'm smart, you know. I do okay.
My skin is tan. My hair is fine. My hips imbibe you. My mouth like wine. Whose little girl am I? Anyone who has money to buy. What do they call me? My name is Sweet Thing. My name is Sweet Thing.
Never really been treated differently due to my skin tone. I don't feel that I'm dark or light skin. I fall in the middle, which has been a little weird for me because there's so much debate between darker girls and lighter girls, but not so much conversation around just those of us who are in the middle of the spectrum. I do think that if I had to choose a side, I would choose darker skin side of the spectrum. And sometimes I might hear guys say, oh, I have to marry a light skin girl so that my children can have a chance at not being dark. And I know that if I have children, they might not be light skin, they might be dark skin, dark. You know, they can be either or. And so to me, that means, well, I might not have the beauty or the characteristics that most people are looking for in a partner. Personally, I don't get offended because I embrace all skin tones. I just feel that people who make those comments have self-hate towards themselves, and that's just their way of processing it and dealing with it. Instead of embracing who they are and loving who they are, they want to prevent their children from self-hate, from
hating themselves as well. Hi, I'm Jasmine Sosten. I'm 25 years old. I'm from Port Barry, Louisiana, and I am a school teacher. As a child, I didn't know I was dark-skinned. Like, I went to a school, and it was majority white people at the school, so it was always a white and black issue. It was never, like, oh, you're dark, or oh, you light issue. My mom's light-skinned, my dad's dark-skinned, and they never made me feel weird about my color or that I was less of a person. It wasn't until I went to college and I started dating that I felt like it was an issue that I was dark-skinned. Being dark-skinned was the area that I had the most struggle with. And it's what really made me feel like it was an issue to be dark-skinned. Because like the females, my friends, they were fine. Like, they never made me feel any type of way or whatever. But my first real relationship, I remember his family, well, he invited me to his family reunion. And okay, so my family told me to not go to the family reunion because his family did not like dark-skinned people, that they were not fond of dark-skinned people, and that I would feel out of place, or that I would look out of place, because I probably would be like one of the very few dark-skinned people there. So I made up this lie, this excuse of why I couldn't go to the family reunion, and then later, not immediately, but later, I told him why I really didn't go. And I thought he was gonna tell me, oh, that's a lie, like, you know, white people like dark-skinned people, girl, you tripping. But he was like, no, that's right, like, they don't. And that just made me feel weird. Like, I don't know if I changed their mind about dark-skinned people or if it's just like they put up with me until we weren't together anymore. I don't know. But the second person that I dealt with dating was this guy, and he told me, you're the first dark-skinned girl. I'd heard that so many times. Like, you're the first dark-skinned girl I ever talked to. And I'm like, really? Like, you know how many times I've heard that? And so it's like always, you're the first dark-skinned girl. I don't talk to dark-skinned girls because they normally not attractive. You're so pretty for a dark-skinned girl. Yada, yada. The list goes on and on. It's like, oh, you're so chocolate, this and that. And then they start making these nicknames. They call you like Blackie or... I was like, that sounds like a dog name. Why would you call me that? And just all kind of stuff. Like, and I know like a few times I would be like, don't call me that. I don't like that. Yada, yada. And they would just like laugh it off. And I'm like, no, like, I really don't like people calling me things like that. And they were like, why? That's like stupid. And I was like, just don't call me that. And then they make me feel bad for standing up for myself. You know, like, oh, it should be cool for me to call you Blackie. Or like, we're at a family event and you say, oh, y'all like my black girlfriend, and she's so black like, but she's so pretty. Like, why would you say something like that? Don't you think that would make me feel uncomfortable? So like, those are things I dealt with.
My name is Kiara Beverly and I'm 23 years old. I'm from Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
Before I went natural, I had, you know, long blonde, gold hair, and people would say, you know, you should really embrace that. You should capitalize on it. You know, it's going to benefit you when you go on interviews. And so I kind of felt like, hey, you know, I mean, I want to embrace the fact that I'm African American. It's been difficult for me to kind of connect with that innocence. I don't know, because I've never really, like, I know I'm African American. I know that, but it's been kind of difficult to connect with it because of all the things that people have told me in the past about embracing my skin color and, you know, not really connecting with the fact that I'm African American. I know I'm black on the inside, but sometimes people don't perceive me as being black because of my skin color and my hair color. Well, when I was in the fifth grade, one of my classmates, we've been in class since kindergarten, so she's known me, she's known my parents and everything, and so I don't remember exactly what I said in the classroom, but I remember her saying, Kiara, you need to stop acting black. And I'm like, Megan, what do you mean I am? And she's like, no, you're not. Look at your hair, look at your skin, you look just like me, you're not black. And I'm just like, first of all, what's acting black? You know what I mean? What did I say to just assume that, okay, I'm acting black? But, you know, you know, you've seen my mom, you've seen me, or, you know, interact with my how do you assume that I'm, you know, not black? A few years ago, actually, I was interested in this guy, and, you know, I really liked him, and I thought he was into me, and we had a, like, really serious sit down, and, you know, I was like, okay, you know, we hang out all the time, I think you're great, you think I'm great, but, you know, what's the deal? Why haven't we moved forward? And he was like, well, honestly, I've never really thought about dating anybody with albinism. What does that mean? I think that hit me the most, just because I never considered my albinism being a reason why somebody would consider dating me. You know.
My name is Ariana Walls, and I'm 24 years old. I'm originally from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. I don't think I've really been treated differently because of my skin tone. I've been always mixed, in a mixed crowd, so I haven't really experienced any negativity, and I don't really associate with people who, you know, do negative things towards people just because of their skin tone. So I can't really say that I've experienced any source of colorism. I mean, there's definitely like certain cases where guys will say to like some of my friends that are light-skinned, oh, you're acting light-skinned, and you know, you really don't understand what that means because, you know, what is light-skinned, you know, but they really don't know the person that they're talking to, so they think that they're stuck up or think that they're better than them, but they're really not. Usually, like, if girls won't give them any time of day, you know, like, oh, you're acting light-skinned, and sometimes it's usually darker males who say it to light-skinned women, and I guess they think that the women think that they're better than them. I just love, you know, any shade of color. I've dated light-skinned, I've dated dark-skinned, so I really, that's not really a factor that is a make or break for me. I've had guys tell me that they've only dated light skin, and when I ask them why, they just say, you know, a lot of them say that they see themselves with light skin just so their children don't come out dark, and but, you know, not too much of that, because I try to stay away from that.
My name is Christian Smith, and I'm 19 years old. I'm from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. I don't have a preference, but the trend seems to be that I like light skin girls more than dark skin. So I don't think it's a reason behind. It's just the girls that I come in contact with. I don't really come in contact with a lot of dark skin girls. So that's
what it is. My name is Brandon Gatlin. I'm 36. I'm from Lafayette, Louisiana. In regards to what I was interested in coming up, light-skinned females versus dark-skinned females, the culture of the city that I grew up in clearly had some sort of deference towards light-skin, or what we would call red bone. However, I understood that there was value in both. What I've seen going forward and growing up is that these days, it's more of an issue within the ladies themselves. Women are beautiful. They come in all shapes and sizes, colors, and melanin levels. However, when a woman doesn't have esteem of self, as some comedians have said, then it then detracts from their physical beauty and their attraction level. So I would venture to say, if a woman carries herself like she knows that she's beautiful, that translates, and the pheromones are in the air, and I catch those. So light skin, dark skin, they're all beautiful. It's just about, do you think you're beautiful, woman? I know that's a different approach than a lot of people would take in regards to light skin versus dark skin. And I won't say that initially I didn't have some predilection to light-skinned females, but they're all beautiful. And as you grow and experience the world, you start to understand that there are many different types of people, and there's different things that you can get from people. So I wouldn't want to totally throw away a whole subsection of this spectrum just because of a lack of melanin, or some may have more than others. Women are women, and it's the person that's inside that really makes the difference. I mean, a car is a car. It's all about the driver that determines where the car goes, right? When it comes to the media, I would venture to say that women have done more harm to themselves than men. If you look at the executive producers of most of the reality shows that are prevalent on television today, those are women, and those are Black women. So I would say that it's a popular misnomer to assign the blame to the Black man or to men in general, when in fact, it's not us. It's the women who are profiting from that. And if you really take a look at the lyrics of rap songs, of certain love songs that talk about different colors or melanin levels of women, they're really just in a descriptive manner. They're not judging. They're not placing value. They're just saying that she was this color or she was that color. That's all. So if you really do the research, it's not the men. It's actually the women doing it to themselves.
My name is Phil Randall, and I'm 22. I'm from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. As a young age, I always thought, you know, light-skinned girls was winning. But as I got older, I started thinking, like, it don't matter what color you is. If you're bad, you're bad. You can be red, black, blue, white. If you're bad, you're bad. I want to say maybe middle school, maybe. I just thought that light-skinned girls look a little better than dark-skinned girls. But as I got older, it really didn't matter anymore. I started dating different color girls as I got older. I don't think anything that really happened. I think that I just started seeing a lot of darker girls who was actually beautiful. And I was like, maybe I can get at a try, and, you know, things turned out well. I had multiple friends that have dated dark-skinned girls and light-skinned girls. So I think all my friends like both of them. Because I have heard that people say that you are cute for a dark girl. And me being dark, like, I never really liked that statement. Because, like, if you're beautiful, you're beautiful, no matter what color you are. I would say love yourself. If you think that you're beautiful, I'm sure the next person thinks that you're beautiful, too. Treat yourself as you just as beautiful as the next girl, no matter what color you are that she are. Treat yourself as that you're beautiful.
I'm Nick Harris. I'm a 23-year-old from Rosedale, Louisiana. I go for the texture of the skin, the color. It's not a big deal for me. You know, more so if she keeps her body up, keeps her skin up. And also, I'm real big on personality. So if she has a real great personality, she almost has me. So definitely, I would say a dark-skinned girl is more down to earth or more relatable to a Black male. Normally, light-skinned women get the stigma of being stuck up or bougie, maybe even a little dingy. But like I said, I don't really judge a book by its cover, but sometimes it's proven correct. But I'm a person who like to get to know the person before I like, you know, judge them. It's definitely a great feeling to disprove a stereotype about a person, you know. We're in a day and age where a lot of people judge about their outer appearances, and we only go about that, but it's really about what's inside of a person. So getting to know the true person can disprove, like I said, the stereotype, and also, you know, change the mindset for yourself and also for the culture. Definitely, men do play a big role in, you know, how women see themselves and how they dress themselves because of their skin tone. Because, you know, we are in a day and age where we rely a lot on what we hear in music and what we see on TV. And so I know men go for a more curvier girl now, and those women who feel like they lack in that area do feel self-conscious and also feel like they need to fit the stigma that we have in society. So men do play a big part of it. I know through music videos, men who might like a skinnier girl might go for a curvier girl because they feel that's what's in at the moment. So I always try to go with what I like. You know, even if I do like a curvier woman, if it's a slimmer woman who has a great personality and great complexion, I'll definitely go for her as well. I'll definitely tell today's woman to have self-confidence in yourself and self-respect always. You know, a man will like what a man likes, but it's all dependent on you. One who lacks confidence is a deal breaker for most men. So definitely to you women, just stay motivated, stay confident, and just be yourself, and you will have no problems in the world.
My name is OG3, and I'm 19 years old. I have to have, like, smart women. I mean, like, something going for themselves, not, like, just nobody going to sit around. Like I said, it's really a mind thing. Like, I want to know how you coming and what we going to take, where we going.
No matter the shade,
we all have a voice. My question I wanted to pose was, when you're thinking that we do kind of buy into team light skin versus team dark skin, how does that affect your relationship with each other as females? Like, do you feel like we're at least a little bit better at trying to encourage and empower each other, or is it just every woman for herself?
When I think of our little girls, like, that are growing up in this age, like, when I was growing up, I didn't have an Instagram. You know, Instagram didn't exist. So now that I think of our little girls that are growing up and that are learning about themselves through social media, you know, they're learning how to feel about themselves, how their self-esteem will be based off of the interactions with other people and other kids on social media, even the stuff that we post. You know, they see that and they look up to us. I have students that follow me, you know, students that I used to teach that were in high school or in middle school or whatever. And if I'm posting something that's like even derogatory toward me or derogatory toward light-skinned women or whatever, they can take that as my views, you know, and kind of shape the way they feel about themselves.
Be careful, yeah, even if it's a joke, not everyone is going to take it as a joke, right? Do you think that females buy into how we interact with each other and our relationships with each other? Do you think it's as separated as males seem to be? Because especially like if we're talking about the internet and social media, like you hear kind of light skin versus dark skin, and it's a lot of men kind of being like, oh yeah, this dude over here, he light skin, I'm team light skin, I'm team dark skin. Do you feel like females buy into that as much as males seem to?
I think so.
You think so?
Yeah.
Easily. The picture, it's like a group of light skin girls and we're the main ones reposting it. The light skin girls, like, this picture smells like unread text messages.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like
unanswered DMs.
Right. Drake voicemail. So like this whole perception, you know what I'm saying? It's mm-hmm. like, of course, they have the bougie light skin. She don't talk to nobody. She like, I refuse to repost that. Like,
yeah.
My DMs are dry.
Good for you.
My DMs are dry, first of all. You know, like, if you text me and we're dating, I'm texting you. There's a responsibility mm-hmm. to be conscious of, you know, who you're empowering. You know what I'm saying? Like, what are you empowering? What are you putting your energy behind? Like, for me, I was telling her, like, I understand the privilege that comes along with being a light-skinned woman. Like, I'm not going to sit up here and be like, woe is me. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, oh, you call me white. Well, you're calling her ugly. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, there are differences, but that's my power to say, don't disrespect my sister. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's my power to be like, I'm not going to post it. Like, I'm not going to feed into it. My friends, my chocolatey friends, like, let me remind you daily, like, you know, we're not going to play that role where I'm going to go walk into the club and she not. You know what I'm saying? Right. Oh, no, you know, we good, brother. We're going to both leave. It's never, like, that's your power. I'm not posting that because I don't want to be a part of making you feel worse.
Less than, right.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But I think that's that sisterhood that I hope everybody starts to buy into, you know, as any of us in a position of privilege or power, it's our responsibility to help the next person, mm-hmm. not be like, oh, I'm good. I got me.
Right.
It's like, as your position of privilege, when you see it in certain circumstances, mm-hmm. to help someone who is not being treated as well. Like, we have to help each other. And a lot of times it's just all about me, me, me. Like, I'm good. What's going on with me? But we have to think about our sisters, you know, the ones sitting next to us.
And even the ones that are coming up, like, I mean, when I was younger, you know, I definitely had this big stigma about being darker. Like, that was like a big thing in my community. It, colorism was like a huge thing, you know, and I was always like the friend. Like, you know, I had like the light skinned friends and then I was like the dark friends, you know, that like was like, hey, you know, can you hook me up with your friend? You know, your light skinned friend. Right. So I kind of always had like a thing with that. And it really was only even like all throughout college, like that was like a big thing for me. I was so insecure about that. And, you know, I had to just like learn how to understand who I was as a human being, you know, and in Christ, but but just knowing who I was as a woman and what that meant for me to be Black, what it meant for me to be a Christian, and what it meant for me to, you know, to other people, to other young ladies that may have the same insecurities that I had growing up. And just to say, look, you're beautiful. The way God made you this way, this is how you are, because you are crafted and made this way. And that's not a discredit to who you are. It's not like a knock against your self-esteem, you know?
I wish I had known you back then. Because I would have told you, knowing what I know now, that like colorism is just like, is BS, you know? Like,
yeah.
I wish I could have told you that guys may on Instagram post these memes about how they prefer light-skinned girls, but if they were to see you and meet you in person, they'd be like, oh my God, let me get with that chick.
Right,
you
know? Well.
Do you guys ever find yourselves kind of just altering how you may naturally want to feel or act because of your skin tone?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I do the exact same thing that you do. You know, I even had this interaction with this girl the past week, like, I knew that she had really conservative views. She was a white girl or whatever. And you know, I was like, man, you know, I'm not even going to go. I really want to like let her have it. You know, she kind of came at me on some Black Lives Matter type. And so I just was like, I really want to let her have it. But I held back because I'm like, this is my job.
Right.
It's a work environment. This is, you know, this is where I'm going to school. And I don't want to perpetuate the stereotype of the angry Black woman that always has an issue, always has a problem, especially being darker, you know, so.
I think to go on what you're saying, I did that like all my childhood and college life, like not really speaking up because I didn't want people to think that I was an angry Black woman or that I had like issues or insecurities, so I just didn't say much. And then I realized they're gonna say and think what they want anyway. So
yeah.
I'm just gonna be myself.
So you.
Now I'm like, making, you know, evolving and just making sure that, okay, I'm gonna say what I need to say, whether you feel a certain way about me or not, because you're gonna say it anyway. And as Black women, we just need to stick together and like empower one another to not feed in, like we have our own voice and we need to stand up for our voice. Like just because we're women doesn't mean that we can't speak up for ourselves.
I feel like on that, on my end, it's like I think about being in the office and them assuming just because I have been quiet for so long, they think that I'm very passive, you know, like I just kind of try to stay in my lane and do my own thing. But like it's really important to like let it out. So at one point, like they're having their conversation about Alton Sterling, and we represent Crime Stoppers, right? So they want us to do something with all, you know, police stuff, and we're thinking of a billboard. And the guy cracks a joke, and he's like, let's put Alton Sterling on there with his crime sheet. Snapped. Like, that was the first time I feel like they realized Megan is a Black woman. You know what I'm saying? Like, snapped, cut conversation, that's not funny.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And you could hear it, you know, a needle fall on the ground, because it was just like, oh, like, she's really Black. But it felt good, you know what I'm saying? And from that point on, like, yeah, they still have their conversations, and but they might whisper in their office, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm going to have this voice. Like, let me be angry. You can think I'm angry, but you're not going to do that in front of me, not my people. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, I don't care anymore. Like, I want to keep my voice. I want them to know that we care. So, yeah.
I think that's awesome. It's all about, I love that, keeping your voice.
Yeah.
For me, being a Black woman means being strong, being supportive, being a friend, being somebody that has a voice.
To me, being a Black woman means being independent, being courageous, being love.
For me, being a Black woman means being determined, being sassy, and being love, kind of the same thing Latrice said, just representing love, emanating love to others around you, to your family, to your spouses, to your children, and to everyone you come in contact with. Just being love.
To me, being a Black woman means being playful, having a sense of enjoyment of life, but also taking things seriously, being concerned about what's going on in the world, because of what our ancestors have gone through and having to be accountable for everything that they've sacrificed for us, for our generation. So carrying the burden of their trials and trying to push the next generation forward.
For me, being a Black woman is being the backbone that just kind of holds up the community, you know, the men, the children. We are that, being charming, like so much finesse. Like, it's ridiculous how crazy lit it is. It's unity, it's love. It's just like a clubhouse that everybody can't be in, because it's just extra special and it's extra important and it matters. Like, Black women are everything.